Good afternoon to everyone. Today my lecture will talking about the adrenergic modulation of innate immunity and the emerging role of stress and stress-related disease. I just want to tell you that during my PhD and during my year of postdoc, I met several times the topic of stress. So I was very interesting to know more about the stress. And we started from the historical use and etymology of stress. So on Wikipedia, we can very easily find the definition of stress, that the stress is a form of Middle English distress derived from Old French Old French from the Latin stringere, that means to draw tight. The word had long been used in physics to refer the internal distribution of a force exerted on a material body resulting in a strain. This man was actually the first person who discovered the stress. His name is Hans Seyl. And his first idea of stress born in the 1925 when he was a medical student. During his clinical visit, he observed that many patients manifest the same symptoms, and even if they have a different disease. Which symptom he observed? They have generalized pain like tickling, stomach disorder or weight of loss. And he called this general disorder Malaise syndrome. So he was very interesting to this generalized pain, and he referred this to a professor, but they didn't give to him much attention, and they suggest to him to focus it on the specific characteristic for each disease for the patient. So what did he put a rise for several years this Malaise syndrome, but he returned in the 1935. He returned while he was doing research about a new hormone bovine. In fact, he injected ovaries of bovine in the mice, and this injection caused a several reaction. For example, they give a big adrenal cortex, the thymus was reduced, and the stomach and intestine appeared to be bleeding ulcers. So at the beginning, he said that he never observed all of these symptoms. So he was thinking that he was discovering a new sex hormone. But unfortunately, his enthusiasm disappeared very quickly because during other experiments, he injected an extract of different organs, such as placenta, spleen, and kidney, and he noticed the same symptoms. So he was very disappointed for this. And at one point, he decided also to inject in the mice formalin. And what he obtained the exactly the same result. So the observation was, it seems that any toxic substance would cause the same reaction. So he was very sorry, disappointed, and he said, all of my dreams disappear to discover a new hormone. But what happened? During this year, this idea of Malaise syndrome, he never forgot this idea that he has. So at one point, he thought back to the observation made when he was a medical student. And he remembers also the symptoms that were caused by many diseases. And he recognized again the same symptoms that were big adrenal gland, small thymus, and bleeding ulceral. And also he remembered that the doctor in that case, the course that the doctor gave to the patient were the same. They suggest to the patient to eat good food, to take a rest, and to stay warm. So in that moment, he arrived at the idea. Seyl, in one of his books, wrote, if you could show that the body has a general and non-specific model reaction, which is caused by a variety of potential pathogens, it's a specific defense reaction of the body. So in that moment, born the concept of stress. Of course, he published his work on nature in 1963, and he called this malaise syndrome with the word stress to describe the non-specific response syndrome. He was unaware that the word stress for used for century with the physics to explain the elasticity property of a material. The theory of general adaptation syndrome, like Sale called, explains the three stages of stress reaction. The first stage is alarm reaction, then resistance, and then we have the exhaustion phase. The name of these three stages were associated by the way of body to release cortical hormones. This syndrome details how stress induces hormone and how this hormone can lead to the ulcers, high blood pressure, atherosclerosis, arthritis, and also allergic reaction. During his life, I told you that Sale wrote a lot of books and article, of course, but the most famous is this book, Stress Without Stress. But how today we can classify the stress? I must tell you that today we can classify the stress in three big groups. One is a psychological group in which stress is defined as a change of homeostasis provoked by psychological and environmental stressor. The second group is a physiological group in which stress is a stimulus that is internal or external that activates the hypothalamic adrenal axis and sympathetic nervous system, resulting in a physiological change or adaptation. And the third one, the stress is defined like a personality and a socio-environmental factor that are pertinent to the individual adaptation. But what stress causes on the body? We need to say that the sympathetic nervous system releases noradrenaline, but also the chromophyll cells of adrenal gland release 80% of adrenaline and 20% of noradrenaline. Catecholamines are also important because for the flight or fight reaction, and also catecholamine has a lot of function on the body because they increase the blood pressure, for example, or dilatation of bronchi, or also glycogenolysis. But in the last year, it was underlined the role of stress because they interact through the adrenergic receptor with immune cells. So, for all these reasons, we can say that the sympathetic nervous system and hypothalamic adrenal axis represent the major pathway involved in the crosstalk between brain and immune system. Today, my lecture is based on stress and stress-related disease. During the year since 1984, a lot of work were published because some research has the idea that stress played a role in etiology of many diseases, and also because the stress can have a detrimental effect on health and immunosuppressive role in the immune function. What stress does? In the literature, it was demonstrated that stress has a profound effect on immune function, and for example, the psychological stress, like speaking public or doing arithmetic, very fast arithmetic task, increase the level of some inflammatory cytokine like interleukin 6, and also the chronic stress, such as a depression, is associated with the state of chronic low grade of inflammation. So we can say that inflammation is considered an integral part of a stress response. Today I want to show you also another classification of stress, because stress has a bidirectional effect on immune function. The stress it's possible to have two different kinds of stress, acute stress and chronic stress. The acute stress immune-enhance and has a protective role on immune cells, while chronic stress has an immunosuppressive role and can result in increase on inflammatory cytokine gene expression, maturation or trafficking of immune cells, and is a consequence can also lead to the vascular damage. How is possible that stress can lead to the vascular damage? We need to see, I must tell you that is not so clear. Some author thinks that this is possible because there is an alteration about the balance between sympathetic and parasympathetic system with the regulation of hypothalamic adrenal axis. As a consequence, there is an alteration of the functionality of the cardiovascular system and the development of more of the early atherosclerosis disease. I explained to you that we have two different kinds of stress, that acute stress seems to have a protective role of immune function, while chronic stress no. In this work, published in 1997, the author showed that after acute stress, there is a rapid decrease of leukocyte number in the blood. This decrease is this decrease represents a redistribution of leukocyte from the blood to several organs, for example, skin, lymphonode, or bone marrow. And the author wants to show us that the adrenal stress hormone are the main mediator of this leukocyte distribution. This redistribution of leukocytes may serve to enhance the immune function in some of the compartments in which leukocytes are moving consequently to the stress. So I said that skin is one of the targets in which leukocytes are trafficking. So what they want to show this author, he wants to hypothesize that leukocyte redistribution increases the immunosurveillance and as a consequence enhances the immune function. For to demonstrate this, to test this hypothesis, he examined the effect of acute stress on skin immunity by using a model of antigen non-specific mediated immunity. This test is called delayed type hypersensitivity, in which the skin is exposed to antigen after acute stress. Contrary to the idea that stress suppresses immunity, this study reports that short duration of stress enhances the DTH response. And how it enhances? The author took three groups of mice, the intact mice, sham, and in another group he did the adrenalectomy. And he induced the stress. The stress was administered by placing animal in a ventilated plexiglass box for 2 hours. What he observed? In this graph, we can see three different groups, intact, sham, and adrenalectomy mouse. The hormone media in white we have the control and in the black we have the stress. The hormone mediated of stress induce an enhancement of skin immunity and improve the clinical picture of disease. This happened also in the sham mice. But what is very interesting that the adrenalectomy, which eliminate totally the glucocorticoid and the epinephrine, eliminate totally the stress-induced enhancement of skin DTH. What he do after this, what he does after this? They administered also epinephrine or corticosterone or both, and they saw that this administration increase the number of T cells and also cytolytic T cells, and as a consequence, they have an enhancement on skin DTH. But we know that the stress causes a release of adrenaline, noradrenaline, but also cortisol. So he also want to understand which is the role of these different hormones in the response of skin. In this first part, he do a curve of epinephrine response. He administered different concentration of epinephrine from 0.05 to 0.5 milligram per kilo. And as you can see, there is an acute administration of epinephrine that enhanced the skin DTH. This other set of experiments, he administered the epinephrine and cortisol, and they also observed that epinephrine and corticosterone enhance the skin DTH response. But what was very interesting is that if they mimicked a chronic stress and they did administrate 400 milligrams of corticosterone to the mice, as you can see, there is a significantly suppression of skin. Here we have cortisol, and here we have the stressed mice. So, what is the conclusion of this part? That this result suggests that adrenal stress hormone is an endogenous immune enhancing agent in which stress may help to prepare the immune system for potential challenges. I told you that today we will speak about stress and the innate immune system. So we need to say that there is really few information about the sympathogenic regulation of innate immunity. The innate immunity is composed by effector molecules such as complement or antibacterial peptides, but also include cells like granulocytes, neutrophils, eosinophils, basophils, and mast cells. And also monocyte dendritic cells, natural killer, and the last one are the alpha de delta gamma T lymphocyte. The innate immune system is usually considered, as we know, the first line defense, of defense against microorganism. But there is a contribution of this immunity in several diseases like atherosclerosis, inflammatory disease, multiple sclerosis, neurodegenerative disease, obesity, diabetes, and also in cancer. We need to say that several extended reviews were written about the communication between nervous system and immune system, but really few work speaking about the role of innate immune system and its adrenergic regulation. This last work, Elenco, and also our work, Scanzano e Cosentino, is written about talking about the adrenergic modulation of innate immunity. What we can say about this? We can say that, for example, the NK cells express beta-adrenergic receptor that are usually inhibitory, as well alpha-adrenergic receptor with undefined functional relevance. The monocyte express beta-adrenergic receptor, which, however, may be lost during maturation to macrophage. And the activation of monocyte beta-adrenergic receptor is usually an anti-inflammatory if there is any condition in which they can be pro-inflammatory. On murine dendritic cells, beta-adrenergic receptor mediate the sympathetic influence on dendritic cells, T-cells interaction, but few information today we have about the modulation on human dendritic cells. We know that the beta-2-adrenergic receptor may affect the TH1-TH2 differentiation of CD4 cells. In microglia and astrocyte, beta-2-adrenergic receptor dysregulation may contribute to the neuroinflammation in autoimmune and neurodegenerative disease. And the isoproteinerol, that is the beta agonist in fusion, caused the gamma delta T lymphocyte mobilization in a dose-dependent manner. And this mobilization is greater than T lymphocyte and less than NK cells. What we know about adrenergic receptor in a human neutrophil. I need to tell you that this was my PhD program, and we published this article the last January, in which we study, of course, the adrenergic modulation of migration, CD11B and 18 expression, ROS interleukin 8 production by human neutrophil. The first question was, Do catecholamine influence PMN function involved in the genesis of inflammation? We know that after inflammation, the neutrophils were recalled from the blood and they adhere to the endothelium thanks to expression of beta-2 integrin. And then after this, they pass through the endothelium in which they release ROS or interleukin 8 or interleukin 6. So, first of all, we analyze the combination of the effect of adrenaline, noradrenaline, and isoprenaline on PMN migration. As you can see in this graph, the adrenaline at a different concentration inhibit the migration induced by FMLP, and the same effect were observed with noradrenaline and isoprenaline. Then we moved to analysis of adrenergic stimulation of the protein expression of beta-2 integrin. The beta-2 integrin is an integrin that is very important for the firm adhesion of neutrophils to the endothelium. It's composed by two subunits, CD11B and CD18. As you can see in this graph, the noradrenaline, adrenaline, and the beta agonist isoprenaline are able to reduce the CD11B expression induced by FMLP. What was interesting that the isoprenaline, the beta agonist, also at a lower concentration, is the only one that significantly reduces this expression, suggesting a beta role in this process. But for understand which kind of receptor is involved in this process, we performed the same experiment with selective antagonists for each adrenergic receptor. For the selective antagonist prazosin alpha-1, alpha-2-ioembin, and the beta non-selective antagonist propranolol. The ioembin and propranolol antagonize the inhibitor effect of adrenaline, while the prazosin increase this inhibitory effect of adrenaline. Then we move to analyze the effect of adrenaline on the ROS production. Again, we say that adrenaline reduces the ROS production induced by FMLP. We performed the same experiment with the antagonist for each kind of adrenergic receptor, and we can say that prazosin or ioembin reduce the inhibitory effect of adrenaline, while the propranolol is the only one that is able to revert completely the inhibitory effect of adrenaline and bring the value compared to the positive control that is FMLP. Suggesting again a beta role in this process. For all this reason, we started to analyze the mRNA expression of adrenergic receptor. We isolated the cells and put in culture in resting condition and stimulated with FMLP. Adrenergic receptor are expressed in resting condition with the exception of alpha-2 beta adrenergic receptor, and the stimulation with FMLP increase their expression. It's interesting to note that the beta adrenergic receptor beta-1, beta-2, beta-3 are the only one that has a higher level compared to the alpha adrenergic receptor, and they are upregulated significantly if they are stimulated with FMLP, especially the beta-3. After mRNA expression, this preliminary data done thanks to the collaboration of Laura Pulse and Magda De Giglior, we analyzed the immunofluorescence expression of adrenergic receptor. Here we have beta-1 adrenergic receptor in resting condition and stimulated with the FMLP, and here we have the beta-2 adrenergic receptor and stimulated with the FMLP. I'm sorry that it maybe is not so clear, but in blue is marked the nucleus, and in red we have the spot of that is the protein adrenergic receptor. As you can see, maybe you cannot see, but there is a lower expression in a resting condition, but if we stimulate the cells with FMLP, this expression increase. Later, we moved on the same experiment in which we analyzed the beta adrenergic receptor in flow cytometry. Here we have the number, but preliminary data show that the expression of beta-1 adrenergic receptor in resting condition is around 23%, while it lowers the expression of beta-2 adrenergic that is around 10%. The next step will be to perform the same experiment with the simulation with FMLP. After this, we also where we moved on the analysis on morphology of PMN. If neutrophil were put in culture in resting condition only with adrenaline, only with FMLP and adrenaline plus FMLP. These are the imaging taken to the same microscopy. We can say that the morphology of the cell treated only with adrenaline are not so different from the cell in resting condition, while the morphology is very different if we see this PMN simulated with FMLP, because here we can see this proto-vesicular extension of the cell that are typical from the activated cells. The incubation with adrenaline induces this round shape of adrenaline that is different, for example, from these activated cells. So adrenaline is also able to give some modulation in the morphology of neutrophil. The conclusion of this study is that adrenergic modulation of PMN is predominantly inhibitory and is mediated mainly through the activation of beta adrenergic receptor. But in the literature, there are a lot of work in which they are speaking about the implication of beta adrenergic receptor in several diseases. For example, in the early, but also in the younger athletes, after acute resistance exercise, we have a decrease of the density of beta adrenergic receptor. And in hypertension, but also in diabetes 1 type, there is a decrease of expression of beta adrenergic receptor. Maybe this indicates maybe a relationship between dysregulation of adrenergic pathway in PMN and development of cardiovascular and metabolic disease. Another interesting work that we found in the literature is one work of 2013. Show the modulation, the sympathoadrenergic modulation of hematopoiesis. And the author did a link between stress, inflammation, and atherosclerosis. For this idea, they start to analyze the impact of stress on the human immune system. What they did with this scale, they checked the stress of 29 persons who are working in the hospital intensive care unit, and they analyzed their stress on duty and off duty. As you can see, the stress, of course, on duty is significantly compared to the off duty. In the same population, they analyzed leukocyte number and of course on duty and off duty. As you can see, there is an increase of leukocyte number in the blood, an increase of neutrophil, monocyte and also lymphocyte. So the stress induces leukocytosis. For study better this phenomena, they reproduce the same effect on the mice. They took two different group of mice, non-stressed and stressed, and they stressed the mouse with several procedure for several days, with a lot of procedure, for example, overnight illumination for 12 hours, change tilt for 6 hours, dumb bedding for 6 hours, and so on. What they obtain? That the leukocyte number increase compared in stress mouse compared to the control, but also neutrophil and monocyte. So this observation is the same that they observed in human. But of course, we know that stress determine a production of noradrenaline. So what they did, they go to check the level of noradrenaline in a stressed mouse, and of course there is an increase of production of adrenaline compared to the control. They also analyzed the expression of tyrosine hydroxylase, that is the enzyme that limits the synthesis of catecholamine. And as you can see in this graph, there is an increase of tyrosine hydroxylase expression compared to the control. But what was very interesting for this work, that if the level after stress, if the level of noradrenaline increase in the same time, the mRNA and protein expression of CXCL12 decrease. What is CXCL12? CXCL12 in hematopoietic niche are derived from mesenchymal stem cells, osteoblasts, and endothelial cells. And his function include the inhibition of hematopoietic stem and progenitor cells, proliferation and migration, and also it is important to retain neutrophil in the bone marrow. What they also observe that in the hematopoietic niche there is a high expression of beta-3 adrenergic receptor. So after this observation, what they did? They took one wild-type mouse and they checked the mRNA expression and protein expression of CXCL12. As you can see, the stress decrease these the stress mouse decrease the expression of this factor, while if they administered the beta blocker, we have a total reversion of this process. What does it mean? That means that stress increases noradrenaline. Noradrenaline acts on beta-adrenergic receptor, and as a consequence, there is a change in hematopoiesis. How the actor connect the hematopoiesis with atherosclerosis? Because we know that atherosclerosis is an inflammatory disease characterized by intense immunological activity, which lead to the formation of atheroma. In these two images, we have an atherosclerotis plaque that was snap thanks to SEM microscopy, and here we have the cartoon. In atherosclerotic plaque, we have a rich inflammatory state, rich of immune cells. What the cells do in atherosclerotic plaque? After mobilization of these cells, neutrophils, but also monocytes or mast cells, are recalled in the tissue, in which they release a lot of factors such as ROS, metalloproteasis, and elastasis. And all of these factors contribute to the tissue destruction and the plaque erosion. We know that there is a lot of risk factor for atherosclerosis, such as obesity, genetic factor, diabetes, smoke, hypercholesterolemia, sedentarity, chronic inflammation, also the age or hypertension. But in the last year, it was paying a lot of attention on the role of stress, because many physiological and psychological stress have been implicated in initiation and also in the development of atherosclerosis. Atherosclerosis disease. So after this observation, what the author did? They took the atherosclerosis prone mice, they stressed the mouse for 6 weeks, and as you can see, the stressed mice has an increase, significantly increase of hematopoietic stem cells compared to the control. What does it mean? Means that there is an increase of neutrophil, monocyte, and macrophage number. And of course, all of these cells lead to an inflammatory process because they release a lot of inflammatory cytokines such as interleukin-1 beta, interleukin-6, metalloproteasis that contribute to the thinner fibrous cap and larger necrotic plaque cores. So what finally they did, they stressed the mice and they administered the beta blocker. As we can see, the beta blocker reduced the number of neutrophil, monocyte, and also macrophage. We can say that there is a direct link between hematopoietic progenitor activity and atherosclerotic plaque inflammation. In summary, this work shows us that the decrease of this factor 6CL12 bring to the hematopoietic stem cell proliferation and enhancement of neutrophil and monocyte production, and as a consequence, a lot of release on inflammatory cytokine, and this process is blocked with the beta-3 adrenergic receptor, are able to block the disease of the progression of disease. Okay, I speak about sympathetic modulation in atherosclerotic plaque, but as I told at the beginning, there is a lot of disease connected with stress. I don't want to spend a lot of time on multiple sclerosis because the professor Marco Cosentino do a good lecture at the beginning, which he explained very well this disease, but just very briefly remind you that also multiple sclerosis, that is an autoimmune disease disorder of central nervous system, is characterized by inflammation, demyelination and axonal loss. Many factors are involved in the development of this disease, and much attention are paid in the last year about the stress, because stress maybe can cause this, is a consequence of this disease. This table, I want to show you this table that also Professor Marco Cosentino explained very well to us, in which the author wants to show that there is association between multiple sclerosis and the major stressful event of the life, for example, the death of a child or also the war stress. In one study, comparised 21,000 persons who had lost child compared to the person who has not lost child. This study indicates a significantly high multiple sclerosis risk in parents who has lost child than in parents who has not lost. And this is, the same happened with the person who were exposure to the war stress compared to the person who has not. But how is connected with immune cells? We need to say that after stress, were released the hormone, but also the neuropeptide that interact with the adrenergic receptor and interact also with the mast cells and microglia. And as a consequence, they release a lot of cytokine, like for example, interleukin 6, TNF beta, histamine, VEGF, and so on. All of these cytokines lead to the maturation and activation of CT17 autoimmune cells. There is also a destruction of the blood-brain barrier, and the T cells are able to enter in the central nervous system and promoting the brain inflammation and contribute to the multiple sclerosis pathology. But the innate immunity is also connected with the cancer. Because, as you can see in this cartoon, the sympathetic nervous fibers release noradrenaline and adrenaline, that are these yellow spots, that are able to interact with immune cells, but also with the tumor cells. For example, if the catecholamine interact with immune cells, there is a this interaction results in a production of immunosuppressive molecules such as CTLA4 or arginase. On another hand, the interaction of catecholamine with NK cells inhibit the production of important activation cytokines such as interferon gamma, interleukin 2 and interleukin 12. Of course, catecholamine interact also with the immune cells, and this interaction may lead to an increase of expression of pro-survival and pro-metastatic molecules. What is also interesting is that within the bone marrow, the SNS signaling stimulates also the development of monocytes and granulocytes that are able to enter in the tumor. In tumor bed and resulting in a pro-inflammatory shift of leukocyte pool. In this situation, all of these cells, the endothelial cells, metastatic cells, and immune cells, release a lot of factors such as TNF-beta, metalloprotease, interleukin-6, and VEGF. Of course, they release VEGF and interleukin-6. So yesterday we had a very excellent lecture of Basu in which he speak about the role of catecholamine angiogenesis. But today we want to focus it on the role of noradrenaline and adrenaline on the angiogenesis because the interaction with noradrenaline or adrenaline bring to the production of interleukin-6, interleukin, or VEGF and increased angiogenesis. Why is important to inhibit the angiogenesis in a tumor situation? Of course, because if we understand how to decrease this process, it will be very interesting for the development of new therapeutic strategy. Using to regulate the pathway to improve the patient's outcome. But a lot of work demonstrated that the stress caused a release of catecholamine and as a consequence the VEGF production in vitro. In this work, the author stressed the mice, and as you can see again, the stressed mouse, that is this green line, compared to the control, increased the level of noradrenaline and also cortisol. What they did? They stressed mice, and then after this, they induced tumor. They induced a tumor with ovarian carcinoma cells. What they observed? That stress mice has an increase of tumor weight compared to the control and also the number of nodules. Not only this, they also do another experiment. They isolate the mice and they saw that the social isolation of the mice is able to increase the tumor weight significantly compared to the control. And also in this other group, in the same group, we have also one bigger adrenal gland compared to the control. And based on literature that talking about the expression of beta-adrenergic receptor on ovarian cancer cells, the author of this work performed a series of cells in action. The author treated the mice with PBS, with non-specific beta agonist isoproterenol, with beta-2 agonist turbutaline, with beta-1 agonist exameterol, and with isoproterenol plus beta blocker propranolol. As we can see, the beta-2 agonist and isoproterenol are able to increase the tumor weight, while exameterol has no effect, while if they administer the propranolol, there is a reversion of this process. They performed the same experiment in stressed mice, and again, propranolol is able to revert the is able to decrease the tumor weight induced by stress. To confirm the relevance of beta-adrenergic receptor, they identify two ovarian cell lines that are negative for the beta-1 and beta-2 adrenergic receptor. And as you can see in this graph, there is no difference between stressed and control in these two groups, suggesting, of course, a role of adrenergic receptor in this function. They analyze also the angiogenesis. What they did in the mice that were stressed and induced tumor, they analyzed the VEGF expression in immunohistochemic, but also in the protein. They analyzed the VEGF and also the CD31, that is one marker for angiogenesis. Again, stress increase the tumor production of EGF, propranolol alone has no effect, while propranolol and stress reverted this process. They mimicked the stress. How they do? They suministered to the mice isoproterenol that increased together with turbutalin the expression of VEGF and CD31, while the beta 1 antagonist xametrol has no effect, while to the contrary, if they suministrate the beta antagonist propranolol, is again able to revert this process. They analyzed the angiogenesis in vitro. VEGF, of course, increased the angiogenesis, while if they stimulate the tumor cells with noradrenaline, again, they have an increase of angiogenesis. They also study the number of blood vessels, and the number of blood vessels in stressed mice is increased compared to the control. And also, what was interesting, that they saw that in stressed mice there is a decrease of pericyte compared to the control, and this is suggesting a more immature vascularization. Finally, to determine if VEGF had a key role in acceleration of tumor growth induced by stress, they repeat the same experiment with the two VEGF inhibitor for the receptor. This VEGF inhibitor and this anticorpor monoclonal. And as you can see, the suministration of VEGF inhibitor and anticorpor monoclonal again is able to reduce the tumor weight in the mice. So we said that VEGF production can be arrived from the interaction of catecholamine with the tumor, or can arrive also with an interaction of immune cells. In the last year, it was underlined the relevance of neutrophil in the development of tumor, because neutrophil that were found in the tumor bed release a lot of factors such as interleukin 1 beta, TNF alpha, or interleukin 6 or 12 that are important in the inflammatory cell recruitment. Also, the release of azurophil granuli are important for the tumor cell proliferation. Is important also the interaction between beta 2 integrin with endothelium for the extravasation and metastasis, but is very interesting because neutrophil release VEGF that is important for tumor angiogenesis. About this topic, in our laboratory, we are submitted now this work, Pinoli et al., in which we study the production of IL-8, VEGF, and elastasis in human neutrophil. What we did? We separate the cells and we put in culture in resting condition stimulated with FMLP, LPS, and IL-8. And we analyze the expression of IL-8 and VEGF and elastasis after 3 hours of stimulation or after 24 hours in RNA expression and also in protein expression. As you can see, the stimulation increase the level of interleukin 8, VEGF, and also elastasis. What these molecules do on angiogenesis? In these days, we performed also the angiogenic assay, in which we stimulate the cells with neutrophil with FMLP. After 3 hours of stimulation, we put the surnatant of these cells on Matrigel and UVEC, and we performed the angiogenic assay. As you can see, the stimulation with FMLP is able, all the products that release neutrophil are able to form a new vessel. And this is, of course, evident compared to the resting cells. So, what we can say that PMN were found in tumor bed. PMN are able to release proangiogenic factor. PMN are able to form tube-like formation. PMN express adrenergic receptor, and the adrenergic modulation of PMN is inhibitory and is mainly mediated by the activation of beta adrenergic receptor. The literature show that there is a a beta-adrenergic receptor role in tumor cells, the question is if it is possible that there is also beta-adrenergic modulation or adrenergic modulation of PMN in cancer. That will be the next task that I hope we will perform. We understand that chronic stress has a detrimental effect on the health. The question now is it possible to reduce the chronic stress? This spectrum explains that we have good stress, that is a short stress, that actually is the fight or flight reaction, and we have the bad stress, that is chronic and long stress. Between these two kind of stuff, there is an resting zone. So how we can improve this resting zone? We can improve this resting zone with lifestyle, for example, sleeping, nutrition, exercise, also with the social support, but also with the several activities, for example, yoga, walking, dancing, music, what the person likes to do. If we do all of this stuff, we can have a maximum of resting zone, and this is important because we'll have a protective role on immunity, on the cognitive and physical performance, but especially on the health. Last year, Professor Bellani talked at us that the role of psychoneuroimmunology, because it's a new branch of the psychoneuroimmunology, of course, in which the psychological therapy are used for manage the acute stress and also the chronic stress. This therapy, it was also developed in patients with the cancer. Several work show how social support in patients with cancer are good for some of immune function. For example, social support has been shown that the patient with ovarian cancer that follow a social support has a lower level of EGF compared to the person who not follow this therapy. Or we know also that angiogenesis is also can stimulate by the balance between pro-angiogenic factor and anti-angiogenic factor. Pro-angiogenic factor such as VEGF, interleukin 6 and interleukin 8, and anti-angiogenic factor like arrestin or PEDF. Interleukin 6, that is one angiogenic factor, it's also important because it's able to destroy this balance. And in the person who has a poor social support, has a high level of interleukin 6 compared to the control. I told you that in the tumor bed there is a lot of release of metalloprotease, TNG alpha, VEGF, interleukin 6. Metalloproteases are also important because they can affect the tumor invasion. The person who had poor social support has a much higher level of metalloprotease compared to the person who has not. But also, psychological stress is important also because downregulate the immune response. Person who follow social support has a NK number much higher compared to the person who not follow this therapy. For all of this evidence, in this month we write one project in collaboration with Professor Bellani, Ospedale del Circolo, in which we want to study the role of psychological intervention on immune response in patients with breast cancer that follow chemotherapy or radiotherapy. We, of course, start from the background that stress induces release of catecholamine that interact with immune cells, and this interaction lead to the pro-angiogenic factor that able to form new vessels. So what we want to do? Our plan is that we will have two groups of patients. one that follows only chemotherapy or radiotherapy, another group that, of course, follows chemotherapy and radiotherapy, and also the social support. What we want to do? We want to take, I'm sorry because it's a cut the slide, but we want to take four samples at the diagnosis of disease, before the surgery, after surgery, and after this therapy. And after this, we want to analyze if there is a difference between a person who follow this difference between population A or population B. What we expect in the first group, we expect that chemotherapy and radiotherapy only, of course, decrease the tumor weight, but we expect that they maybe will have a high level of catecholamine that can affect negative the immune function and maybe the angiogenesis. In the second group, the person will, of course, follow chemotherapy and radiotherapy and social support. We expect, of course, a decrease of tumor weight, but probably this therapy will be caused a low level of catecholamine, and probably, of course, they will have a positive effect on immune function, maybe in a decrease of angiogenesis. So, in conclusion, we can say that stress is a consciously or unconsciously an alteration of homeostasis of person, that the response to stress are orchestrated by the brain, especially the autonomic nervous system and hypothalamic adrenal axis, which also represent the major connection between brain and immune system. The stress is a risk factor for many diseases, and numerous studies have shown the contribution of innate immunity in several non-infectious diseases such as atherosclerosis, multiple sclerosis, and cancer. And the adrenergic modulation of innate immune cells is a growing field, and understanding of this pathway may lead to the development of new therapeutic strategies to improve the patient's outcome. I open this presentation with Sale, and I also want to close with his sentence that I like so much, because he said, we can say that much of what Sale believed was not correct. He was unaware of many components that later were demonstrated to be important to the instrument of the stress orchestra. His really legacy can be summarized with this sentence that I really hope that is a wish for all the students and for all the younger researchers. He said, "Theory don't have to be correct, only facts do. Many theories have a value only for their heuristic value. That means they encourage others to discover new facts which can lead to the better theory." With this wish, I want to say thank you for your attention.